so we're way ahead of it.
First and foremost, I'd like to thank Jim Linares, my father, for setting this up and let me have this opportunity to share what I do with everybody. I'd like to talk about briefly what we're listening to right now. These are the sounds of insects and birds and frogs right at the transitional period between the daytime and nighttime, right as the sun setting. There's this transition between all the forest animals, ones that are going to bed and the ones that are waking up for the evening. And then there's certain insects that are only awake and only active during these dusk and dawn periods. And those are called crepuscular animals. And so this soundtrack that we're listening to here now captures a number of these species. So this is dusk on Pipeline Road in the middle of the Panamanian rainforest. And you can listen to some cicadas, the high frequencies, a bird at the low frequencies, a number of crickets and cicadas. More on this later. Before we actually enter the rainforest, I'd like to talk to you a little bit about sort of my path that I've taken as a scientist and how I got to be on Pipeline Road in the middle of the rainforest at dusk. So first, I'll walk you through some of my current research on ant personalities. And then I will walk you through some other rainforest creatures that I've encountered during my time with him. So you see, this is a map of the Western Hemisphere here. And my first real job as a scientist was right after I graduated. I was a field assistant in Peru, studying bird nesting behavior. As some of you know, I spent 4 months there. And then I did my master's degree at University of Missouri, and I studied treehopper communication, learned how they communicate through vibrations, Missouri species up here. And then for my PhD research, I went to Arizona State University and had my field site in Gamboa, Panama. And so I'm not going to be talking about the first two. I'm just going to be focusing on the last one. So let me talk to you a little bit about my research interests and how I got involved in what I'm studying. So everybody around us here today encounters personality of humans all the time, right? Everybody we know has a different personality. So basically, if we try to find this idea of personality, you can think of it in the animal behavior sense as behaviors that are consistent across time and across context, right? It's a very simple definition. And there's been an explosion in the animal behavior research the last 10 years that is interested in personality not of humans, but of all other animals. And they've been finding a number of animal species that display personalities. Birds in Europe, stickleback fish, and even spiders, they've shown to have these consistent tendencies to be more aggressive, perhaps more bold, while other individuals are shy, more reserved, more calculated, calculate their risks, their rewards, all that stuff more often. So I took this idea, and being interested in ants, I went to ASU to study ants. I thought, well, everybody focuses on individuals. So what if there was a collective personality? Sort of not just the personality of an individual, but the personality of a group as a whole. So I was thinking each ant in a single colony has its own personality, right? Has certain tendencies that it does over time. And this combination of different personalities may lead to consistency and behavioral tendencies across time and context at the colony level. So you can think about testing an entire colony of ants where this entire colony is more, on a regular basis, more aggressive, more bold, whereas this colony over here is less aggressive, less bold, more calculated, more reserved, shy, and all that stuff. It's a trade-off between these two life strategies. And this could give us really interesting insights on what does personality come from? Why does personality even exist? Why aren't all of us flexible enough to act optimally in every situation that we're encountering? So, to answer that question, I decided to go to the rainforest and study this specific system that lends itself to these questions. So here we are at St. Louis University High School. Well, let's take a trip to the rainforest. In Panama. A place called Soberania National Park. So I was brought here because I applied to this fellowship that the Smithsonian Tropical Research Institute and I pitched this idea of collective personality. And they said, sounds good. Why don't you come here and figure some stuff out, see what you can find. So that's exactly what I did. Let's get in the mood here a little bit and throw that rainforest music back on. So now we're in the rainforest. And I'd like to talk to you a little bit about this Azteca cecropia system that I studied. The basic gist of it is there's these ant colonies that live inside of cecropia trees, these big, beautiful trees that grow really fast. And there's a mutualism going on between the ants and the plants. And instead of just staying here talking to you about it, I'm going to show you a little video that my friend Andy Quitmire, who's actually sitting right over here, filmed and edited and threw together. So, what's up? Here it is.
The cecropia tree is one of the most abundant species found in clearings and forest gaps in tropical rainforests. In these regions of high competition amongst plants and animal species for survival, much of this tree's success has been attributed to a special mutualism. Cecropia trees provide a safe, climate-controlled shelter for housing a fierce ant genus known as Azteca. In addition, these trees supply nutrients to their ant colonies through tiny growths called Mullerian food bodies, which are harvested by the ants. These serve no reproductive purpose for the plant, but are produced exclusively for the nourishment of the Azteca colonies. In return for food and shelter, the ants act as the plant's nervous and defense systems. Invasive, destructive elements, such as herbivores and leafcutter ants, are quickly swarmed, immobilized, and removed from the tree. The ants even help the cecropia tree ward off competitive, encroaching vines. Also, tiny specialized hooks coating the surface of the trunk work together with spurs on the ant's legs to increase the ant's grip strength and overall defensive capabilities. researchers at Arizona State University and Georgia Tech are working together on new digital tools for understanding biological interactions and mechanisms, such as those leading to the success of this Azteca, Cecropia, ant plant hybrid.
Let's give Andy a round of applause. So that's the mutualism in a nutshell, actually. So you can see this is a cross-section of an open tree, and these little food bodies the ants store inside and use for nutrients. And in return, they protect the tree from herbivores. So they'll attack and dismember any type of katydid or small insect, and even drive away large vertebrates. So this system is really good to study, I thought, because you can study these interactions. You can study them in the field. You can move them to the greenhouse for a little bit more control. And then to look at individual personality and individual behavior, you can actually study them in the lab. So the first experiment that I did, I focused on this personality, is I looked at five traits. Defensive aggression is an obvious one. Is there differences in aggression between colonies? Exploratory tendency, prey capture efficiency, response to leaf damage, and patrolling behavior. And I aimed to look at 30 colonies, but I ended up only being able to look at 10. And I tried to control for size by colony size by looking at the same size trees. And then I aimed to repeat each trait test 8 times, but I ended up only looking at it twice. Kind of ran out of time. So I just want to focus on that first test that I did, and this was looking at defensive aggression. And this is just a little schematic of how I tested it. And basically, with the help of, again, with Andy Quitmeyer over here, I created this flick-o-matic robot, which I mounted on a tripod. And unfortunately, it's not working currently. But this thing would flick at a constant force at regular intervals, flick the tree, and agitate the ants. They started pouring out of the inside. And I videotaped the whole thing. And basically, took the videos and looked at the amount of ants that were on the stem 1 minute before I started flicking and 1 minute after. I just took the net difference. What is the overall colony aggression response to some stimulus? And this is what I found. Just to orient you to this graph, the colony aggression score is basically the net difference in ants. So if this is a high number, then the colony was very aggressive. A lot of ants were put up on the stem. And if it's a low number, then no ants came out. And you can see this dotted line is 0. And so each one of these bars here is a different colony score. And this is scaled by tree size. So you can see there's no real pattern with colony size. Some of these, and you can see there's consistency in their aggressive behavior. So they're consistent across time. And there's very large differences between colonies. You can see this one is very highly aggressive, whereas two colonies actually went and hid. There was less ants on the stem after I flicked the tree than before. So these are shy colonies, whereas these are more aggressive colonies. So this is the first evidence towards something like collective personality. I cannot say by any certainty that these ants actually display collective personality yet. There's many more tests to be done. But this is a step in the right direction. So aside from the personality thing, I actually found this interesting behavior that these ants do that I called head flicking that nobody had ever documented before. When I crush an ant and give it to the colony, the ants do this really funny looking behavior here. There it is, the head flicking. Like they're at a rock concert there. In slow motion. Totally jamming out here. And what the heck are they doing? obviously they're alerted to this, potentially this crushed ant that I just gave them. I just gave them a crushed sister. And they were like, oh my goodness, there's something terrible happening. I don't really know what this is actually doing. So the next step that I did was, okay, I know they had flicked a crushed ant. The next step is to see, maybe there's a chemical in either the head, because it emits these pheromones through the mandibles, or the abdomen emits a chemical through the abdomen. Does it, here's a control, does it head flick to a frozen ant where there's no chemicals being emitted? Or just a toothpick itself, just no ant at all. And what I found was they flick a lot to the head and the gastro, especially the gastro, which is the abdomen, is the term for ants' abdomens. And they still, about 40% of the time, flick to frozen ants and just the stick. So it's sort of like this alert, alarm behavior, I'm thinking. And when I go back to Panama, I'd like to take a further step to see what is actually happening with these head flickings, and what are they doing, and what is the consequence of the colony? So what if they don't head flick, what would happen? If they do head flick, is there some sort of cascade behavioral effect that goes on throughout the colony? So that concludes my research portion of this talk about the ants, and I'd love to talk to anybody who's curious about any further research in that direction. But for the remainder of the talk, I'd just like to walk through the rainforest and take a survey of the different types of life that I found there. Back at dusk, our pipeline road in the middle of the rainforest. So first, I'd like to show some images of just the forest alone. Type of atmosphere that you find yourself in the rainforest. The hardest thing to capture in pictures is the depth of the forest. Everything gets compressed to one layer, and it just looks like a confusing mess. When you're actually standing there, moving your head around, the depth of the forest is so striking. I find that streams do a really good job of allowing for this depth to come through a little bit better. Canopy high above doesn't allow much light down to the forest floor. So there's so many levels of plants and animals at each different light regime along the way down. And here's a view from the top of the town I was staying in, across the way, looking out over Sobrina National Forest. And the plant composition changes entirely depending on the light level that's available. In disturbed areas where there's less light available, or where there's more light available, fast-growing plants fill those gaps really quickly. So this is bamboo here, laying on the floor, looking straight up. And where there's little light available, these larger trees dominate. And to anchor themselves over a wide area, they grow these things called buttress roots that extend like fingertips all the way out. And that's not necessarily to gather water, but that's to support their height of the tree because they grow so tall, over 40 meters. And there's these thick, woody vines that are growing everywhere in the forest called lianas. And some people estimate that these lianas make up 30% of the canopy cover at the top of the rainforest. So basically what they do is they don't grow any leaves here down on the forest floor, but they creep up to the top of the trees and use those to grow off of and spread their leaves. As I mentioned, some of these trees grow incredibly tall and incredibly big. Here's five of us, adults, at the base of a tree here, all raising our hands up, and you can't even see the top of the tree. And here's that same tree from a different angle. Here's me, right here at the base. And the sides of this tree you can't even see. The buttress roots are extending way out of the picture. And again, here's another large tree that I found. So you can imagine being in the deep of these forests, where these giant living monuments have been covering the forest for hundreds of years. It's pretty humbling to walk amongst such ancient friends. And the flowers are beautiful. And some people think that plants just grow and they don't behave. And that's usually true. But sometimes there's an exception. And usually that happens to be in a rainforest, of where exceptions usually happen. And so I'd like to show you a little behavior or a video of plant behavior. So check this out. Moving on to another kingdom of life on Earth is fungus. And fungus plays an incredibly important role in the rainforest, breaking down nutrients so they can be recycled by other plants and animals, breaking down the dead. And there's fungus all over the forest floor. Not just the forest floor, but you can find it all the way up in the canopy. All different strange shapes and patterns and designs. This one looks like some sort of tree in the wintertime. And not only does the fungus break down the dead, but sometimes they infest living creatures, insects particularly, and they crawl into their brains, and they tell this insect to climb as high as it possibly can before it kills its brain and it clamps down onto the stem, and the fruiting body of this fungus grows out of the top of the head of these insects and releases its spores to rain down upon all the vulnerable insects below to have the same fate. And this is a picture of an ant that fell to that fate. And you can see this fungus stalk growing out of the back of the head of this ant, manipulating its behavior in order to propagate. It's a nice transition to move into another kingdom. Insects, animals. So this is some sort of Styracosaurus that manifested itself as a caterpillar here. And this sucker is pretty big. He's about this long. All types of jumping spiders all over the place. And what's really cool in the rainforest is when you see spiders, usually when you see spiders, well, I don't know about
everybody here. But when I see spiders in Missouri, they're usually hanging out in their web waiting for something to eat, or, you know, they're trying to hide from a shoe, something like that. But in the rainforest, I'd say probably the majority of spiders I see are feasting, actively feasting on some sort of insect that fell in their web. Because there's insects and spiders everywhere, and the circle of life is just continuously manifesting itself. Every moment, it's just, life is just in your face. And this is a giant bumblebee that actually Andy Quidmire found. Gorgeous eyes. And this thing was probably about that big in my palm of my hand. And it's a male, so luckily it doesn't sting. And this is a queen leafcutter ant. She's ready to start a new colony. And these leafcutter queens, once they start from very humble beginnings, they dig a tiny little hole in the ground, lay eggs, those eggs hatch, she discards her wings. Those eggs hatch, the workers emerge, and they start to forage on leaves in the jungle, on the plants. And they bring those leaves back, and they don't eat the leaves. They actually feed the leaves to a certain fungus culture that they're growing down under the ground. So they're getting food, basically, for their farm, their fungus farm. They're agriculturists. That's what they do. And these colonies grow and grow. She lays many more eggs. And she only mates at one point in her life. That's before she started digging this hole. And she uses that sperm to fertilize the eggs for the rest of her life. And how long do you think this thing lives? Any guesses? Potentially this queen?
A couple years?
26 years is the record for the age of a leafcutter queen that we know of. So these colonies grow to millions and millions of individuals that forage the canopy leaves and bring down to their massive, massive underground cities to feed their farms underneath.
So when she dies, does the whole colony die?
Yeah. Once she dies, there's no more workers being produced. And that the workers that are still alive will still live for another year or so. But then the colony slowly fades and crashes. You saw this picture. So this sucker here is probably the most feared insect of the rainforest. Certainly the most feared ant. It's called the bullet ant. And it's called that because its sting feels like you're getting hit by a bullet if you get stung. And it's regarded by many sting connoisseurs as the most painful insect sting, or at least the most painful of the ants, bees, and wasps, is this sucker right here. And it's not a solitary insect. All ants are social. So these things actually have entire colonies of stinging ants, each ant with the potential of each sting to feel like a bullet. And Andy and I, and a couple others, were like, bring it on. Bring it on. Let's try to collect an entire colony of these stinging bullet ants. Let's see if we can do this. And by God, we did it. We collected an entire colony of 436 immensely painfully stinging bullet ants. None of us got stung. And here's a little video of the queen.
Oh my God.
I'm not a very good poster on Facebook, but I'm gonna post some.
Oh yeah, you gotta post about this one.
Hard drive? Okay.
So what, were they all doing the same motion?
Yeah, they're all grooming and cleaning. We just destroyed their whole nest, uprooted them, and put them in this giant bin. Yeah. Oh, so that's actually interesting. We had an advantage because usually these things nest underground, and people try and dig them up with shovels and just get destroyed. You know, after two stings from this thing, you want to call it quits, like on life almost. we had the only reason why we actually were this crazy is because we had the opportunity. These guys nested in a log that was propped up against a tree. It was already out of the ground. So what we did is we took a shovel and we took a giant like recycling bin type thing, and we slammed it in half and scooped one end into the recycling bin, the other end into the recycling bin, and we ran it over to this parking lot. And we basically, like, grabbed chunks at a time, slammed them down on the parking lot, and so the log would break open. We had little forceps that we would grab them with and throw them in this bucket. And actually, Andy had a bullet ant crawling on the back of his shirt at one point. And we had spotters trying to check for everybody, and I was trying to grab it and, like, lift his shirt away from his back so it wouldn't actually be able to sting him. But it was climbing up towards his neck, and he was like, "Get it quick, get it!" Like, I'm trying. And finally, somebody else came and just sweeped it off with some other tool. I don't know what it was, but it was a close call.
You stopped the girl who had the machete.
Oh yeah. He goes, "I'll take care of this one." It could have been a lot worse.
Peter, how about your personal account of getting stung?
Oh, yes. I did get stung, not in Panama, but when I was in Peru. I had the pleasure, the honor of being stung by one. Of course, you hear about these things, that they're the most painful sting in the rainforest, and it's like, well, what is it like? You know, it's just this innate curiosity, like, is it worth seeing myself? No, I'm not that crazy. So I see him every day when I was in the rainforest in Peru. And one fateful evening, it was turning to dusk, and I was just doing my surveys of the birds. And I lost my step a little bit, and I grabbed to stabilize myself on a vine. And instantly, it was like before I even touched the vine, there was this jolt of pain in my ring finger, at the tip of my ring finger that just went through my whole body. And I was just like I was shot by a gun or something like that. And I immediately knew what it was because I was like, man, I feel like I just got shot. And then I looked up, and sure enough, there's a line of bullet ants climbing this vine. And then the pain really set in. And it felt like it was engulfed in flames, like somebody had thrown some gasoline on my arm. And it just went up. And I was sort of like, you know, all the endorphins, all the adrenaline rushing through my body, it was like I was laughing almost. It was like some sort of demonical, you know, event. And I was so satisfied that it finally happened. So much pain at the same time. I limped back to camp, like sort of half crying, half laughing. And there some people knew right away what happened. Like, oh yeah, I've seen this. and by that point, my entire arm, all the way up to the shoulder, to my body, had gone completely numb to the touch. And the only thing I could feel was the very pinpoint of my tip of my ring finger. And it felt like it was being squeezed in a vise at the same time as engulfed in flames. that lasted for about 4 hours. And then I tried to go to sleep, and it didn't work too well. But when I got up in the morning, it felt like I had thrown 1,000 baseballs the day before. Like my arm was incredibly sore. I could barely move it. When I did, it was sort of painful. It was like, wow, this is, pitcher must feel like after a really crazy game.
Is it a poison?
It is a poison. Yeah, it's a type of venom. And I'm not really sure exactly the mechanism of what it affects in your bloodstream. But I think maybe it has to do with ion channels, blocking certain ion channels to the nerves.
Now, Peter, would that affect any animal, or is it just humans? Is every animal affected the same?
It's pretty effective against most mammals, at least. Because you have to think, you know, they're protecting themselves largely against something like an anteater, you know, who would love to get their tongues on some of these giant brood that they have sitting in their nest. And they're not going to touch these bullying colonies after one sting from them. As you can see, there's many colors and shapes of these insects. Very shiny chrome beetle here. And a butterfly with incredibly long wings, or moth rather. And this, believe it or not, is a katydid. It's a monster katydid. You want to stay clear of its mouth here, because if this thing chomps on you, it's going to draw blood. You're going to start bleeding. These things are carnivorous katydids. They're insane. Any guesses what that is?
A sloth?
Nope.
Spider.
Caterpillar.
Oh,
that's beautiful.
That's a caterpillar right there. They call this thing the chicken killer. Because it has venom inside of these hidden in spines amongst these hairs here. And it's said to kill chickens if it gets pecked by one. Here's another variety of the Elvis Presley.
Elvis Presley.
Oh my gosh, yeah. Everything looks like a crab.
So this, let's transition to sounds of a midnight stream. We have a few frogs, a few katydids. It was actually in this very river that I took this recording and this picture the same night. This thing is some sort of giant freshwater crustacean, crawdad lobster thing, that is about this big. And I tried to work up the confidence to pick this thing up for about 10 minutes. I was standing over it in the water, just by myself with my headlight, looking at it, and I'm like, oh, it would be so epic. And bring and show. Andy was actually down the stream a bit and be able to pick it up and show Andy. And so finally, after about 10 minutes of pep talking to myself, I was like, okay, just do it. And I reached in and I set my hand on top of this thing very gently. It didn't move at all. And I was like, oh, this is easy. And then I reached my fingers around to pull it up, and that thing wasn't having it. All of a sudden, it burst out of my hands. So you can't see here. There's tiny little bumps and ridges on the back of this thing. And the speed and force at which this thing bolted out of my hands actually gave me scratches on the palm of my hand. I didn't try that again.
Aww.
Moving on to another category of life, the amphibians. And these guys are all over the place. And this, of course, is the classic rainforest red-eyed tree frog. Here's the gladiator tree frog, Rosenberg's gladiator tree frog. Giant pads on its feet here. One of the largest tree frogs you can find in this area of the forest. And here's a cute little hourglass tree frog. In fact, here's all three of them on a pot, by a pond. Here's the hourglass tree frog, the red-eyed, and the Rosenberg's gladiator frog. And of course, you know, we set them there, but they were all like right around this area. So the diversity of amphibians is incredible. Here's a juvenile smoky jungle frog. And a glass tree frog. And this is actually what we're hearing in the background here. The high chucking. And I want you guys to look at this schematic here real quick. At first, they may look like Japanese characters here on the bottom. This is actually a spectrogram of a frog chorus. There's at least 8 different species of frogs singing in this picture here.
Wow.
A lot of them are around this frequency here, from 200 to 1,000 hertz. And then up here, you'll get some more frogs, some katydids, some grasshoppers. And this particular line here is a certain type of cricket. And up here, way up in the high frequencies, all these are katydids, all up here. So you can see the acoustic space is completely filled with all different types of organisms operating all these different frequencies. And the ones that are operating at the same frequencies, like all these frogs here, there's 4 frogs, 4 species of frogs operating in this frequency here. They have different shaped patterns of what their call sounds like so that they can recognize each other and not be blocked by other frogs who are using the same frequency chain. And just to give you an idea of what this sounds like, so this is the actual file here. I was actually driving in the four-wheel truck that we take along the road, and I saw this thing hopping across the road. And I was like, that thing is hopping pretty weird. That's not something I've ever seen before. So I pulled over, I got out, and I picked this thing up. I started looking at it, and I was like, whoa, it kind of looks like a red-eyed tree frog, but it's different. And I took a couple pictures, and I'm like, what the hell is this thing? This is pretty cool. And then I let it go, got back in the car, and got back to some of the other actual frog biologists that were studying Gamboa. And I showed this picture to them. I was like, hey, what is this frog? Jesse, what is this frog? And he walks up, he looks at the computer, and he's just like, no. No, I don't believe it. And he walks away, and I'm like, what? And he's like, no, this is not fair. I don't understand. What is it? And he's like, this frog is one of the most elusive frogs for the rainforest. My advisor, he's saying, this is him saying this, my advisor has been studying this genus of frogs for 12 years and has not seen it.
Oh my God. Oh, look how
pretty. The spectacled leaf frog, that's called. Moving on to other animals, reptiles. Green iguanas are all over the place. Gamboa, Panama, actually. And let's just get a different soundtrack here. Of daytime, pulsing cicadas that are singing almost all day long. So this is what it sounds like midday in the middle of the rainforest. Birds are singing, cicadas are pulsing. And this thing here is a basilisk, or a Jesus lizard, as some people call it, because they have these really wide feet, and they're very light, and they can actually jump and skip across lengths of water, running on top of the water, and reach the other shore. Fortunately, I don't have any videos of that happening, because it happens so quickly, it's hard to capture in a shot. You gotta be ready for it. Hopefully, next time I'll have a video. And it's here. This is me holding a cane. So, my friend Dumont, who is there, he's kind of a crazy guy. And he's never done this before, but he saw a caiman, and he's like, I want to catch that thing. And he jumped in the river, and he caught it with his own two hands. And he pulled it out. And we were all passing it around. I was like, oh, man, get some pictures of this thing. And it makes this really cool sound in the back of its throat, which may be an alarm call to call its mother or something like that. So we didn't hold it for too long. This is a juvenile snake. Juveniles are really hard to identify. I'm not sure exactly what species this is. And this here is the most venomous snake in the area, a fertilance.
Ooh.
Yeah. Yeah. You need medical attention instantly. it's hard to see these things sometimes. They hide out in streams. And this particular one, actually, there's a funny story involving Andy with this one. We were taking a survey of different lizards, and I was looking for cecropia trees along this branch of a river, and it was getting to be about dusk time, and we were all walking along, and I was behind Andy, and there's two people in front of Andy, and we're walking in the stream, right, in the middle of this very shallow stream bed, and Andy steps over this rock. I can't remember if it was me or somebody else, but they're like, Andy, you just stepped over a fertilance. And so he froze, and we're like, oh my God, where is it? And there it was, it was sitting right, he literally stepped over it. Like any difference in his stride, and he would have stepped right on top of it. And so we're like, oh my God, let's take pictures. So that's this guy here. And we're like, okay, cool. We move on, you know, we go down the stream, we, you know, find what we're looking for, we don't, you know, we're just exploring. And then we're heading back down the stream, same way. And the whole time I'm thinking, okay, where was that fertilance? Where was that fertilance? Just make sure we don't step on it again. Because we didn't scare it away, we just kind of left it there. And I'm walking behind Andy again. And sure enough, he steps right over it. Literally right over it, the second time. Literally. I'm like, Andy, you just stepped over it again.
So Peter, do you want to go bake a thing?
Absolutely.
Now, do you have any medical kit just in case? When you said you need medical attention, I mean,
there's a whole protocol that we follow that we can get medical attention pretty quickly there. So we're not too remote. Like in Peru, I was living in the middle of a tent in the middle of the rainforest, 17 kilometers from the nearest village, which was 8 hours away from the nearest city. It's not like that here. In Gamboa, Panama, I'm living in a little village that is actually 40 minutes away from Panama City itself. So, less remote, with more medical attention, so. And this is a rainbow boa, which is a beautiful iridescent pattern you can see in here. So moving on to another organization of life is birds. There are amazing birds in Panama. And this one happens to be one of my favorites. The Rufescent Tiger Heron.
And I actually have a little video of this guy.
That I took with my dad. Yeah, the vibrant colors on this guy's feet. So this guy was actually foraging on these little red berries down here. He was able to get a really good picture of this guy. And you can see these guys often. If you're looking in the right spot, you can see them almost every day. And here's a video of this guy seeing them. Very robotic. Learn some dance moves from that. And this here is a rufous motmot. And one of my favorite parts about this bird is that you follow his tail feathers down. They grow up these skinny little shaft here and then bowl back out to a full feather. Some people think it has to do with communication between species. Some people think it has to do, or not between species, within species. Some people think it has to do with like a warning signal. So they cock it back and forth, kind of like a pendulum of a clock. And some people think that that's a warning to other animals, other species. This is a puff bird, really cute little guy. And this next video I'm about to show you is definitely the best bird video I have. But I have to say, I didn't take it. But I was standing right next to the guy who was taking it. And that was Gumat. And so there's these really cool birds in this area of the forest. There's a bunch of different species of them called manakins. And this particular one that I'll show you a video is the red-capped manakin. And this guy has a really cool courtship behavior to females when he's trying to court. So basically what happens is, you'll see in this video, a female come up, and the male does his courtship behavior, which is a really, really, really hard thing to see in the rainforest. It's like everybody tries to see this. Like this is kind of like the planet Earth moment. You know, where they finally capture on video what they've been sitting there for days to get. So it's kind of at a distance, not the best video, the birds are kind of small, but watch really closely exactly what this male does. And the audio is kind of funny too. Females checking him out. He's doing his thing, pumping up and down. Nope. But this is the best part. The moon dance. Back and forth.
Oh my gosh.
Let's watch that one more time. That's too good.
So cool.
Why the dance?
That's where I'm
So these cute little guys, called the cuties, are all over the village. They're like squirrels. And they love feeding on the mangoes that are just dropping from the trees. So you can see them running around with these big mangoes in their mouth. It's really quite adorable and cute. We've moved on to mammals. There's also a lot of these little guys running around. Armadillos. Nine-banded armadillos root around. This one's a little baby that came up to say hi to me. And there are plenty of howler monkeys here. And I was lucky enough to get a really close shot of this and a really close video of this monkey. So the reason why they call them howler monkeys is probably obvious. They howl like crazy. The first time that I heard these things howl, a thunderstorm had just started. And for some reason, they really get excited, or they really start howling when thunderstorms start. And I had never heard anything like this before in my life. And I'm thinking, there is a dragon in the forest over here. Did you hear the dragon? What is happening here? There is a beast here. And it's an entire troop of these howler monkeys that sing together and create this multi-level, intense sound. And I'll show you the sound clip at the very end, which we're not too far from.
How big are they, Peter?
The howler monkeys are maybe about this, something like that.
Not big.
Not huge, no.
Are they aggressive, or do they bother?
They never come down from the trees to actually physically harm you, but they get pretty scary. If you're walking in the forest, and you have no idea they're above you, and there's a whole troop, and you know, you're just minding your business, and all of a sudden they just rain down with their howls, and it's just like, oh my god, like, I'm under attack. I'm in serious danger right now. My father had a first hand account of this. Do you want to tell that at all?
Yes, you do.
Well, Peter and I were going up the creek, and Peter had his rubber boots on, but I had my leather shoes, so I was trying to keep close to the sides. He was just walking down the creek. So I'm trying to, you know, keep up with him, and I'm ducking things, going over vines and getting caught in thorns and going back to the river and then back up, and I'm, you know, kind of going through. In some parts I'm real low and I'm kind of scampering through there. I don't know what I'm going to find. And all of a sudden, it was like two towers 50 feet high, PV speakers at a Grateful Dead concert just hit me like a truck. It was the loudest thing I'd ever heard. I didn't know what was going on. And they didn't give me any warning. It was just like, wah! And I started running. I'm going, Peter! I was looking for Peter. I thought, this is it. They're coming after me. They're going to eat me. We had a big laugh.
Yeah. I was down the stream there a bit, and I heard a call from me. I was like, oh no, I gotta get back to him.
Yeah. Oh, that's a
good one. Yeah, that's a good description. And this here is called a four-eyed possum, because it's beautiful eyebrows. Kind of look like an extra pair of eyes. Sitting there in the undergrowth. This little guy is called a coati. relative of raccoon. And you get to see these every once in a while. But he was very inquisitive. He actually he came out on the trail we were standing on. Andy was here actually this day. And my dad. Both of us were there. All three of us. And this little coati popped out of the forest and he like, you know, he didn't know we were there basically. He saw us, he was like, whoa. And he kind of like stood there and he backed up and then he sniffed and he backed and he's like, no, I'm getting out of here. Getting back in the forest. He's like, oh, never want to. Oh, definitely not. Back. So we got a double take of this little guy. So that was really, really cool. Really cool. And this, you can't really see what it is, but it's a manatee, believe it or not. West Indian manatees live in the Panama Canal. Yeah. So, actually, I don't know how many of you know, but the Panama Canal is actually fresh water. It's fed by a river, the Chagres River. And it's blocked on both the Caribbean and the Pacific Ocean by these complicated system of locks and dams to keep the seawater out and keep the fresh water in the actual center of the country. So that actually, that's great for all kinds of species because it salt water tends to really limit the what kind of life can live there, and especially around the edges too, because the salinity levels really affect ways of life of a lot of these interior jungle creatures. So it's great because things can swim across, and these manatees are actually able to live in this fresh water here. And this here, I mentioned a little bit before, is an anteater. A tree climbing anteater called a tamandua. And I just love these guys so much. Even though they eat my study seats. Still, and here's a video I was able to get. Standing right there, and he just walked right by, like, who cares about this big thing? I gotta worry about this guy. I don't want him to ruin my day. And this is a little family of. Do you know what these are? Capybaras?
Yes.
Capybaras. The largest rodent in the world.
They're like a cow rodent, cow version of a rodent there, foraging on the edge of a marsh.
And there's two varieties of sloth here in this area. We've got the two-toed sloth, which you can see relatively frequently. It has two toes, kind of has this goofy-looking body and kind of a weird-looking face. But I'm a bit partial to the three-toed sloth, which you can also see. He's actually in this picture. Anybody spot him? There he is, bathing in the stream. And we've got the view of the rainforest stream here. The river is called Juan Grande. I actually have a video because I was able to stand up close to this guy because if you're able to find one of these things on the ground, it's awesome. Because they can't run away very fast. So you get to spend all this quality time next to them, talking about your life histories and stuff like that. While he's, just kind of looking around, Anyway, you'll get an idea for the experience from this video here.
Oh,
Right there, I think he noticed me for the first time. And he's thinking, I gotta get the hell out of here as fast as I can. He's looking for a way to escape right now. What's my best option? down the stream? No, I shouldn't. Well, maybe.
Oh, God.
Okay. I think I figured this out. I'm gonna go underneath. You can see these insects climbing all over me. Insects, large insects that live on him all the time. Oh yeah. You got this thing figured out. He's like, he's never going to catch me.
Peter, have there been any studies about what caused the adaptation of the slow movement? Like, how is this?
They're all about camouflage. So they spend the vast majority of their time sitting still in the canopy, and their scent is totally covered by everything that's growing on them. It smells like everything else around them.
What do they eat?
They eat leaves.
They eat leaves?
They eat leaves, yeah.
Now what would be a predator?
He's cruising.
Eagles actually eat these things.
Harpy
eagles, yeah. The most massive raptor in the world feeds on these guys.
How big are they?
The harpy eagles? These things? I don't know. Maybe like this big? Like the body length?
What
kind of wingspan do you have?
I don't know off the top of my head. But pretty impressive. Yeah. I don't think it's the biggest wingspan of any eagle because it has to maneuver through the thick forest, mm-hmm. So it kind of tucks its wings in as it's flying, mm-hmm. Whereas these other soaring raptors have these really long, broad wingspans, but it's the most massive, and it has the largest talons and the most powerful talon strength of any bird. So, I have one more picture for you guys. And this picture was the best picture I took on the whole trip. I was able to get lucky enough to see this thing. And it was early in the morning. I was walking to go look for some cecropia trees. And I see this thing peer out of the forest. And I'm like, that's not normal. What is that thing? And luckily I had my camera right here, right ready for me. And I stepped up close, and it let me get pretty close. And I took three pictures. It stood there at the forage edge for about 10 seconds to let me take pictures of it. And this is what I saw. Jaguarundi is what it's called. And wildcats are hard enough to see in the rainforest, let alone get a picture of one. And so I showed this picture to a wildcat expert a few days later. And he shook out, he threw out his hand and said, congratulations. And he looked me in the eye and he said, again, congratulations. And he said, and then he started talking about this particular type of wildcat, the Jaguarundi. There's three types of this, three sort of morphs. You got your black Jaguarundi, which is relatively common. Then you have your brown Jaguarundi, is also relatively